I know you're all wondering why we asked you here. Last Thursday evening, I told the American people that the road to economic recovery begins with a responsible budget now. I pledged to them my personal all-out commitment to work with the members of both houses of Congress on both sides of the aisle to break the budget deadlock, and we've been doing that continuously. And last night, in cooperation with the Senate Budget Committee, we took an important step toward the balanced and fair compromise the American people want and our economy needs. We reached agreement on a three-year deficit reduction package totaling $416 billion. Two-thirds of the amount will come from spending reductions and interest savings, only 23% from revenue increases. And while we realize no compromise can please everyone, this one meets the most important criteria. It will continue to bring down the growth in federal spending. It should measure financial markets, or reassure, I should say, financial markets by sharply reducing projected deficits next year and in the years beyond. It will preserve our commitment to a stronger defense and to the all-important incentives to broaden the tax base by stimulating more savings, investment, production, risk-taking, and growth in the private economy. Let me emphasize one other point. This package includes measures to restore the solvency of the Social Security Trust Fund. But as I promised the American people, Social Security beneficiaries will receive their full 7.4% cost of living increase in July, and we will continue to protect the basic benefits of Social Security recipients in the future. And now with me this morning are some of the key leaders in the Congress that we've been working with in the past few weeks. And with their great leadership, and the leadership of many others from both parties, I believe we can put our country firmly on the road to economic prosperity, and I'm going to turn around and say thanks to these gentlemen right now for being here. Pete.
Thank you, Mr. President. President.
Maybe premature, but we'll do the best we can.
Yeah, we have to go to work now.
We sure do.
Yes. We'll see
you
later.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you.
Mr. President,
you have to fund
$40 billion
out of Social Security.
$40 billion out of Social Security.
How are you going to make that up?
Whoops. Wait a minute.
How can you do it, Mr. President?
That figure.
How can you do that without cutting benefits? You said
no.
You won't cut benefits.
That figure is a plug that is simply put in there. Based on, you remember, there is a task force working, a bipartisan task force, on restoring the solvency of Social Security, the integrity of it, which we told the people a year ago was lacking. And at that time, this was rejected, and there were people who told us in the debate that, there was no danger to the system. They now recognize, yes, there is. We have put in that figure as what will be necessary in the restructuring of the program in order to restore solvency to the program. So, all right.
But, sir, why can't you put Alan Greenspan in a dark room and lock the door like Lyndon Johnson did and tell him to go to work now and finish his study?
They are going to work now, and they are working. It's
Can do it quicker?
Well, we gave them till December 31st. If they come in with something earlier, we'll be very happy about it. But that still allows us time.
Can you assure that there will be no cuts in Social Security benefits in the future?
I have said to the delegates that I appointed to that task force that the people who are now dependent on Social Security must be assured that they're going to continue to get their benefits.
Aren't you passing the Social Security buck until after the election, sir?
No, that was decided back when the bipartisan agreement came to have a task force, a bipartisan task force. We made an effort last year to restore the solvency, and if you'll remember, it was made into a political football and not by our doing, and it guaranteed the continued benefits as they are to the people on
Social Security. Mr. President, to make the system solvent, the $40 billion has to come from somewhere, doesn't it? Either from increased revenues or from decreased benefits.
No, it could come from an entire restructuring of the program, looking back down, actuarially looking back down toward people who are just beginning in the program. As you know, there is a gigantic increase in Social Security tax built into the system, passed. Well, it went into effect in 78. We had one increase in the payroll tax in January. There will be two more in the next few years that are scheduled to take place. And the task force is supposed, and that does not restore the solvency, even though the promise was made by the previous administration that that guaranteed the program's solvency until the year 2015. It didn't even agree or guarantee it beyond 1984.
Mr. President,
you said repeatedly that you wouldn't balance the budget on the backs of the taxpayer.
That's right.
But you've now apparently agreed to large new taxes that the taxpayers will have to pay one way or the other, the American public. What made you change your mind?
No. If you'll remember, the original budget proposal we made proposed $13 billion of additional revenues, not necessarily in tax increases, but in changes in the tax structure, advantages that people were getting that we did not believe had ever been intended in the structure. And all we've done is come up on the first year $7 billion on that. Now, that does amount to, as that goes on,
over the
3-year period, when you institute something in 1 year, then that continues and is reflected in the growth of the economy in the years to come. Just as the, but the main thing
what's
that...
What's the figure you've agreed to in 3 years, do you know?
It will be, it's 20 and 35 and 40 in the third year.
That adds up to $75
billion. No, that's 95 billion.
95 billion, my math's right. A little off. Well, isn't that a large tax increase that the American public will have to pay, sir?
Not when you stop to think that maintaining our present tax cuts, as we will, that amounts to $358 billion tax cut over the 3 years. Now, these the things that we're considering are not the kind of things that are going to impinge on the incentive features of the way we have built in the business tax cuts and the individual income tax cuts. That remains intact.
And indexing won't be slipped.
Indexing will not be slipped.
Mr. President, are you now conceding what the Democrats have been saying all along, which was that last year's tax cut was simply too big?
No, not at all. I am suggesting that the fact that we have inflation virtually down to zero and that it has come down that fast, and other factors in the economy that indicate that the recession is bottoming out, indicate that we would have been better off economically right now if they had not made us compromise and if the tax cut had been retroactive to January 1st, 1981 and had been 10%, not 5. We really are not beginning our tax cuts in reality to have an effect in the economy until this first July tax cut. Let me, if I could, also say something else to many of you. You seem to have been confused about something and have referred a number of times that the budget that we first presented in February was a budget that was that included a $182 billion deficit for 83 and then increasing deficits beyond. Let me make something plain. The deficit figures are the figures if nothing is done. They were not. In other words, our original budget proposal would have vastly reduced those deficits. But many of you have continued to refer that our budget proposal contained a $182 billion deficit. It did not.
Mr. President, on another question, please.
On the Falkland Island situation, I wondered if you would comment and give us your assessment, sir, about whether the United States has a creditable role yet to play as an honest broker in that we've come down on the side very clearly of Great Britain rather than Argentina.
Well, we stand willing, as we always have been, to achieve a peaceful settlement under the conditions of Security Council Resolution 502, which calls for both a ceasefire and a withdrawal. And I'm not going to single out any particular approach that we're pursuing, but we're open to every approach that can. We now have the help of the President of Peru, who has involved himself in these negotiations. We'll do whatever we can to help, but it must be within that framework. Wait a minute, I promised him.
On the Falklands,
I
think there is some concern that the Falklands could escalate into a greater war, and some concern even that it could involve eventually the United States and the Soviet Union. What steps have you taken, if any, to try to head that off from happening, such as contacts, perhaps directly or otherwise, with the Soviet Union?
Frankly, I do not see the danger of this escalating to that extent. And the steps that we're taking are the steps that we've always been taking, and that is seeking within, as I say, the UN framework, this kind of a resolution that calls for ceasefire and calls for withdrawal of all forces while this is done. Now, so far, there has not been agreement on that.
Are you committed to following?
Let's take Lou and no more.
Are you committed to following what that commission advocates at the end of the year, even if that means cutting the cost of living increases of Social Security recipients?
Well, this is one. No, I have to say there I'm on record, and I don't think they would do that. I don't think that the people who are dependent on Social Security should be frightened any more than they have been by the political demagoguery that's been going on about this issue. The people who are presently dependent on Social Security must be assured that they're going to continue to get their benefits.
Thank you.
So the Republicans have agreed on now in the Senate.
This plan?
What if they don't buy it, sir? You can't pass it without them, can you?
Well, it'd be rather difficult for them to explain how they did not want to be a party to a plan that was going to reduce the three-year deficit by $416 billion and would give us deficits that would go down from 106 in this first year to 69 next year and to 39 in 1984 with a continuing line downward that makes certain a balanced budget in the next several years.
Are you going to bring the fall guys? You'd say the Democrats had caused the recession to continue if they don't agree to this.
If they can come up with a better proposal or one that will do this, we'd be very willing to listen. We want to work with everybody on this.
Are you going to bring in the boll weevils and start trying to build your own coalition?
My goal from the very first and the reason for the Gang of 17 and everything else was that I believe the American people, in this time of economic distress, should have had the assurance of seeing the Democrat and Republican leadership in the Congress and in this administration stand before them together and say that we have agreed on a plan to help cure this recession, reduce these deficits. And so far, we have not been able to bring that about. But we are going to continue to try.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. Thank you very much.
The Gang of 17.
What?
What do you call them, the Gang of 17?
They named themselves that. They were 17, and they began naming themselves after they got to about 13 meetings as the Gang of 17.
You know what happened to the Gang of Four in China?
Well, but as I told Sarah one day, you know a sweet guy like me would.
Yes.
I know you're all wondering why we asked you here. Last Thursday evening, I told the American people that the road to economic recovery begins with a responsible budget now. I pledged to them my personal all-out commitment to work with the members of both houses of Congress on both sides of the aisle to break the budget deadlock, and we've been doing that continuously. And last night, in cooperation with the Senate Budget Committee, we took an important step toward the balanced and fair compromise the American people want and our economy needs. We reached agreement on a three-year deficit reduction package totaling $416 billion. Two-thirds of the amount will come from spending reductions and interest savings, only 23% from revenue increases. And while we realize no compromise can please everyone, this one meets the most important criteria. It will continue to bring down the growth in federal spending. It should measure financial markets, or reassure, I should say, financial markets by sharply reducing projected deficits next year and in the years beyond. It will preserve our commitment to a stronger defense and to the all-important incentives to broaden the tax base by stimulating more savings, investment, production, risk-taking, and growth in the private economy. Let me emphasize one other point. This package includes measures to restore the solvency of the Social Security Trust Fund. But as I promised the American people, Social Security beneficiaries will receive their full 7.4% cost of living increase in July, and we will continue to protect the basic benefits of Social Security recipients in the future. And now with me this morning are some of the key leaders in the Congress that we've been working with in the past few weeks. And with their great leadership and the leadership of many others from both parties, I believe we can put our country firmly on the road to economic prosperity, and I'm going to turn around and say thanks to these gentlemen right now for being here. Pete.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Howard. President.
Thank you. Maybe premature, but we'll do the best we can.
Yeah, we have to go to work now.
We sure do.
Yeah.
We'll see you
later. Okay.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you.
Mr. President, you have to come from $40 billion out of Social Security.
$40 billion out of Social Security.
How are you going to make that up?
Whoops. Wait a minute.
How can you do it, Mr. President?
That figure.
How can you do that without cutting benefits? You said
no.
You won't cut benefits.
That figure is a plug that is simply put in there. Based on, you remember, there is a task force working, a bipartisan task force, on restoring the solvency of Social Security, the integrity of it, which we told the people a year ago was lacking. And at that time, this was rejected, and there were people who told us in the debate that, there was no danger to the system. They now recognize, yes, there is. We have put in that figure as what will be necessary in the restructuring of the program in order to restore solvency to the program. So, all right.
But, why can't you put Alan Greenspan in a dark room and lock the door like Lyndon Johnson did and tell him to go to work now and finish his study?
They are going to work now, and they are working. It's
Can't you make him do it quicker?
Well, we've gave them till December 31st. If they come in with something earlier, we'll be very happy about it. But that still allows us time.
Can you assure that there will be no cuts in Social Security benefits in the future?
I have said to the delegates that I appointed to that task force that the people who are now dependent on Social Security must be assured that they're going to continue to get their benefits.
Aren't you passing the Social Security buck until after the election, sir?
No, that was decided back when the bipartisan agreement came to have a task force, a bipartisan task force. We made an effort last year to restore the solvency, and if you'll remember, it was made into a political football and not by our doing, and it guaranteed the continued benefits as they are to the people on
Social Security. Mr. President, to make the system solvent, the $40 billion has to come from somewhere, doesn't it? Either from increased revenues or from decreased benefits.
No, it could come from an entire restructuring of the program, looking back down, actuarially looking back down toward people who are just beginning in the program. As you know, there is a gigantic increase in Social Security tax built into the system, passed. Well, it went into effect in 78. We had one increase in the payroll tax in January. There will be two more in the next few years that are scheduled to take place. And the task force is supposed, and that does not restore the solvency, even though the promise was made by the previous administration that that guaranteed the program's solvency until the year 2015. It didn't even agree or guarantee it beyond 1984.
Mr. President, you've said repeatedly that you wouldn't balance the budget on the backs of the taxpayer.
That's right.
But you've now apparently agreed to large new taxes that the taxpayers will have to pay one way or the other, the American public. What made you change your mind?
No. If you'll remember, the original budget proposal we made proposed $13 billion of additional revenues, not necessarily in tax increases, but in changes in the tax structure, advantages that people were getting that we did not believe had ever been intended in the structure. And all we've done is come up on the first year $7 billion on that. Now, that does amount to, as that goes on, over the three-year period. When you institute something in 1 year, then that continues and is reflected in the growth of the economy in the years to come. Just as the, but the main thing
what's
that...
What's the figure you've agreed to in 3 years, do you know?
It will be, it's 20 and 35 and 40 in the third year.
That adds up to $75 billion.
No, that's 95 billion.
$95 billion, my math's too low. Well, isn't that a large tax increase that the American public will have to pay, sir?
Not when you stop to think that maintaining our present tax cuts, as we will, that that amounts to the $358 billion tax cut over the 3 years. Now, these the things that we're considering are not the kind of things that are going to impinge on the incentive features of the way we have built in the business tax cuts and the individual income tax cuts. That remains intact.
And indexing won't be slipped.
Indexing will not be slipped.
Mr. President, are you now conceding what the Democrats have been saying all along, which was that last year's tax cut was simply too big?
No, not at all. I am suggesting that the fact that we have inflation virtually down to zero and that it has come down that fast and other factors in the economy that indicate that the recession is bottoming out indicate that we would have been better off economically right now if they had not made us compromise and if the tax cut had been retroactive to January 1st, 1981 and had been 10%, not 5. We really are not beginning our tax cuts in reality to have an effect in the economy until this first July tax cut. Let me, if I could, also say something else to many of you. You seem to have been confused about something and have referred a number of times that the budget that we first presented in February was a budget that was that included a $182 billion deficit for 83 and then increasing deficits beyond. Let me make something plain. The deficit figures are the figures if nothing is done. They were not, in other words, our original budget proposal would have vastly reduced those deficits. But many of you have continued to refer that our budget proposal contained a $182 billion deficit. It did not.
Mr. President, on another subject, please.
On the Falkland Island situation, I wondered if you would comment and give us your assessment, sir, about whether the United States has a creditable role yet to play as an honest broker in that we've come down on the side very clearly of Great Britain rather than Argentina.
Well, we stand willing, as we always have been, to achieve a peaceful settlement under the conditions of Security Council Resolution 502, which calls for both a ceasefire and a withdrawal. And I'm not going to single out any particular approach that we're pursuing, but we're open to every approach that can. We now have the help of the President of Peru, who has involved himself in these negotiations. We'll do whatever we can to help, but it must be within that framework. Wait a minute, I promised him.
On the Falklands,
I
think there is some concern that the Falklands could escalate into a greater war, and some concern even that it could involve eventually the United States and the Soviet Union. What steps have you taken, if any, to try to head that off from happening, such as contacts, perhaps directly or otherwise, with the Soviet Union?
Frankly, I do not see the danger of this escalating to that extent. And the steps that we're taking are the steps that we've always been taking, and that is seeking within, as I say, the UN framework, this kind of a resolution that calls for ceasefire and calls for withdrawal of all forces while this is done. Now, so far, there has not been agreement on that.
Are you committed to following what that commission advocates at the end of the year, even if that means cutting the cost of living increases of Social Security recipients?
Well, this is one. No, I have to say there I'm on record, and I don't think they would do that. I don't think that the people who are dependent on Social Security should be frightened any more than they have been by the political demagoguery that's been going on about this issue. The people who are presently dependent on Social Security must be assured that they're going to continue to get their benefits.
Thank you.
The Republicans have agreed on now in the Senate.
This plan?
What if they don't buy it, sir? You can't pass it without him, can you?
Well, it'd be rather difficult for them to explain how they did not want to be a party to a plan that was going to reduce the three-year deficit by $416 billion and would give us deficits that would go down from 106 in this first year to 69 next year and to 39 in 1984 with a continuing line downward that makes certain a balanced budget in the next several years.
You're trying to make the Democrats the fall guys. You'd say the Democrats had caused the recession to continue if they don't agree to this.
If they can come up with a better proposal or one that will do this, we'd be very willing to listen. We want to work with everybody on this.
Are you going to bring in the boll weevils and start trying to build your own coalition?
My goal from the very first and the reason for the Gang of 17 and everything else was that I believe the American people, in this time of economic distress, should have had the assurance of seeing the Democrat and Republican leadership in the Congress and this administration stand before them together and say that we have agreed on a plan to help cure this recession and reduce these deficits. And so far, we have not been able to bring that about, but we are going to continue to try.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. Thank you very much.
The Gang of 17.
What?
What do you call them, the Gang of 17?
They named themselves that. They were 17, and they began naming themselves after they got to about 13 meetings as the Gang of 17.
You know what happened to the Gang of Four in China.
Well, but as I told Sarah one day, you know a sweet guy like me wouldn't.
Yes.